Evolution of Intangible Property to Crypto Assets. Legal Pragmatism in Anglo-American Common Law and Chinese Civil Law. Alvin Ho Chan Hung, The Chinese Journal of Comparative Law, Volume 12, 2024, published 07 August 2024. Abstract: the emergence of crypto assets, a novel category of assets, has posed significant challenges to property law across various legal systems. The integration of these intangible assets into property law frameworks proves to be complicated for many civil law jurisdictions, which tend to adhere to dogmatic approaches. In contrast, Anglo-American common law and Chinese civil law systems, despite their divergent origins, have exhibited legally pragmatic responses to intangible property, including crypto assets. By examining the development of their property laws concerning property conceptualization and the treatment of emerging intangible assets, this article explores how the historical foundations of Anglo-American common law in feudal tradition and Chinese civil law in communist ideologies have fostered adaptable and flexible notions of property. This adaptability is argued to be a strength within both the Anglo-American common law and Chinese civil law systems, enabling them to accommodate innovative intangible assets more easily compared to their civilian counterparts. Introduction: crypto assets are digital assets that are created, recorded, and transferred between individuals using cryptography and distributed ledger technology. One as of early 2023. It is estimated that the average global ownership rate of crypto assets has reached 4.2%, with more than 420 million users worldwide. Two, as Bitcoin and other crypto assets gain prominence, a significant challenge surfaces for legal systems globally. The need to adapt established property law principles and frameworks to accommodate this novel category of intangible assets, ensuring that owners can rightfully claim protection for their property rights. Many civil law jurisdictions face challenges in this regard due to their property law systems, which often tend to be dogmatic and seek precise definitions and categories. This article aims to investigate the historical adaptability of property law within legal systems concerning intangible properties, with a specific focus on the common law systems in England and the USA, as well as the unique civil law system in China. The emerging crypto industry has seen significant activity from England, the USA, and China, economic superpowers that have given rise to some of the largest crypto exchanges and companies globally. With an estimated 68 million individuals in possession of crypto assets in these regions, three, the chosen jurisdictions are therefore based on their status as economic powerhouses with substantial involvement in crypto asset activities, while also representing two distinct legal systems that exhibit significant differences in their socio-political and legal cultural traditions. By unveiling and comparing elements of legal pragmatism, this article argues that despite their different approaches, both the Anglo-American and Chinese sides demonstrate remarkable innovative capacity in addressing the challenges posed by the emergence of intangible properties like crypto assets. The article begins by discussing how the pragmatic and adaptive approach of Anglo-American common law towards recognizing innovative intangible property forms traces its origins back to Norman feudalism. The absence of rigid and theoretical definitions of property in its categories, coupled with a legally pragmatic approach in accommodating emerging business practices, allowed common law property to undergo a gradual process of dephysicalization, which eventually led to a smooth recognition of crypto assets as a novel form of intangible property, displaying even more open attitudes towards intangible property compared to England. Various states in America have gone a step further by expanding the scope of the tort of conversion to offer protection for intangible property. It is explored how parallels can be drawn between such adaptability of common law and the approach taken by China in adapting to crypto assets. Chinese law, emerging from its communist origins and characterized by a brief but dynamic history, has pragmatically pursued a deliberate and almost immediate dephysicalization of property through academic discussions and the adjustment of conventional civil law principles within a new property law code. This proactive approach has opened the path for a more efficient recognition of the property nature of intangible crypto assets within the Chinese legal framework. Legal pragmatism, crypto assets and property law traditions. Since Bitcoin's inception as the first crypto asset, Various new types of crypto assets have emerged, becoming the center of attention in personal property disputes. It has become imperative for courts to tackle some fundamental questions: whether crypto assets are deemed as property, and, if so, how their property nature should be interpreted. These issues dictate the suitable approach to address disputes and ascertain the legal remedies available to claimants who assert that their assets have been misappropriated. For instance, amid the collapse of prominent crypto exchanges such as FTX, the property nature of crypto assets assumes paramount importance. This designation not only determines their classification within the ambit of property law, but also delineates their role in insolvency proceedings, allocates priority among creditors, discerns the presence of trust arrangements, and facilitates the utilization of security interests. Unlike disputes involving traditional forms of property, the ambiguous legal status of crypto assets adds complexity. Due to limited legislative guidance, courts must demonstrate creativity in interpreting and applying existing laws to address matters related to these assets. Throughout the process, multiple factors, including policy considerations, social conditions, and notably, the legal system of a jurisdiction, and whether it follows the common law or civil law tradition, inevitably exert influence on the outcomes. England and the USA serve as prominent examples of the common law system, while China exemplifies a civil law jurisdiction. These jurisdictions demonstrate contrasting approaches to property law, influenced by their distinct legal origins, doctrinal principles, and treatment of property. Some scholars argue that, in civil law systems, concepts like property and ownership play a significant role in shaping the organization of their codes, and the precise designation of tangibility and movability assumes great significance as they form the basis for classifying things and establishing their status as objects of ownership. For example, in Japan, a civil law system predominantly influenced by the German civilian tradition, the Japanese court, in the notable M.T. Gox case, 5 ruled that only tangible assets could be legally owned under the Japanese civil code, concluding that bitcoins, being intangible, could not qualify as objects of ownership. 6. The limitation of ownership to tangible objects suggests that the well-defined civilian property system can be restrictive in certain circumstances. Although civil law jurisdictions have managed to integrate crypto assets into their legal frameworks through the laborious process of enacting legislation, due to their inherently rigid conception of property, reconciling these assets with property law principles has proven to be a challenge. Some jurisdictions must amend their legal codes to expand their conventional definition of property in order to acknowledge crypto assets as digital or intangible assets, and in some other jurisdictions, crypto assets must be regulated under securities law rather than property law, as they are intangible and do not fulfill the criteria for property rights. 7. Conversely, common law is said to have more fluid concepts of property and tends to seek pragmatic solutions to property law issues. H. Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr., a prominent theorist of legal pragmatism, famously stated that the life of the law has not been logic, it has been experience. 9. He argued that common sense has consistently prevailed over fictional constructs in common law, leading him to identify pragmatism as a fundamental characteristic of the common law tradition. 10. In the emergence of legal pragmatism as a theoretical framework, scholars posit that law is composed of contextual and situated practices, deeply ingrained in custom and shared expectations. 11. Law is perceived as a highly result-oriented and instrumental system, functioning as a means to attain desirable ends for the betterment of the community, and much emphasis is placed on its adaptability and ability to be customized to meet the evolving needs of society. 12. With an increased consciousness of and regard for the consequences, courts tend to be forward-looking, anchoring policy judgments in factual considerations and their ramifications rather than relying mostly on conceptual abstractions and past decisions. 13. While legal pragmatism is typically regarded as a normative theory, this article argues that several of its elements, such as result-orientedness aimed at effectively addressing the evolving needs and expectations of society, and prioritizing societal needs over theoretical and conceptual abstractions, can be found in the historical treatment of property law principles within Anglo-American common law. This facilitated the natural, anticipated, and efficient recognition of crypto assets as property. This stands in stark contrast to some typical civil law jurisdictions, such as Japan, Germany, and Turkey, which, guided by their relatively rigid property law principles, have taken the stance that crypto assets cannot be recognized as property due to their intangible nature. 14. This article argues that despite its classification as a civilian jurisdiction, Chinese law has exhibited a distinctive stance of legal pragmatism, similar to that observed within Anglo-American common law systems, and this similarity is particularly evident in their respective approaches towards maintaining an open and flexible conception of property to efficiently accommodate the evolving landscape of property rights in contemporary society. 15. This can be largely attributed to Chinese law's unique nature. While its property law system draws heavily from German and Swiss codes, a legacy of Soviet socialism persists, granting a dominant role to the state. 16. Furthermore, the contemporary Chinese legal system and its laws are relatively recent creations, emerging from the aftermath of the tumultuous Cultural Revolution. Notably, China's property law was only enacted as late as 2007, followed by the promulgation of the Civil Code in 2021. As Chinese laws frequently come from state-led initiatives involving Chinese legal scholars, with a keen awareness of international developments. 17. The development of private law in China, as argued by Zhu Wang, emphasizes a pragmatic thinking that prioritizes the resolution of actual issues, giving way to practicability over the aesthetics of legislation. 18. In the following section, this article presents the argument that, despite employing distinct approaches, both Anglo-American common law and Chinese civil law demonstrate an acknowledgement of property's dynamic nature, prioritizing legal pragmatism in order to address societal demands. Furthermore, it discusses the purported constraints of these approaches, particularly the potential ambiguity they might engender, and the challenges that the crypto phenomenon may still face despite these open attitude approaches. Common law approach in England and the USA. In common law, it is well known that property can be categorized into choses in possession and choses in action, roughly translated into the divide between tangible and intangible things. 19. Crypto assets pose a challenge because they do not fit neatly into either category. Since crypto assets lack physical form, the conventional link between possession and tangible assets obstructs the classification of crypto assets as choses in possession. Further, since crypto asset owners do not undertake legal obligations to each other, crypto assets do not embody any enforceable rights, which precludes them from being categorized as choses in action. 20. It appears that, in theory, crypto assets do not fulfill the prerequisites to be recognized as property under common law. 21. Which would prevent them from becoming the subject of proprietary remedies. However, in practice, Anglo-American common law has demonstrated flexibility in accommodating this emerging form of asset. The adaptability, as this article argues, is deeply rooted in the enduring tradition of legal pragmatism inherent within Anglo-American common law, which continues to hold significant relevance in the contemporary era. Dephysicalization as historical progression, intangibles in Anglo-American common law in England and the USA. Although the principle of numerous clauses has been applied to various aspects of real and tangible property, 22. The courts have still demonstrated a degree of flexibility in addressing property rights. The intrinsic flexibility, rooted in historical tradition and expressed through legally pragmatic attitudes of courts, has significantly influenced the evolution of the concept of intangible property in Anglo-American common law. It has also facilitated the incorporation of privately enforced customs and commercial practices into the legal system, leading to their formal recognition and enforcement. 23. According to F.A. Hayek, the tradition of English common law can be traced to the unwritten rules and ancient customs in England that held precedence over even the commands of the sovereign. 24. Taking a different angle, R.C. Van Kienegem argued that English common law should be regarded as originating from continental feudal law. 25. Following the Norman invasion of England and the introduction of the continental feudal system, continental Europe, during the Age of Revolutions, diverged significantly from feudal traditions and embraced Roman law. Meanwhile, the English system continued to evolve based on its feudal origins, gradually acquiring a distinct character, and ultimately becoming known as the most feudalized of all countries. 26. Therefore, we can observe how a civilian jurisdiction like Germany, reflecting the impact of Roman law, has developed a property law system characterized by comprehensive principles grounded in rights and obligations, prioritizing absolute indivisible ownership, while English common law, with its roots in customary and feudal practices, has placed traditional emphasis on the intricate webs of interpersonal connections and reciprocal duties, accommodating a wide range of lesser estates and common use rights, such as the right to graze animals and cultivate food, which coexist alongside the proprietary rights of landowners. 27. There is a temporal emphasis on property relationships, leading to an understanding in common law that the concept of ownership is relative rather than absolute. 28. While it is argued that English common law has shifted towards absolute ownership rights, excluding conflicting interests, a closer examination reveals that its differences with civilian jurisdictions remain substantial. The notions of property and ownership did not even emerge in England until the late 15th century. 29. English common law notably lacks a statutory definition, even in broad terms, of ownership, and it does not have a comprehensive legislative framework for property law. 30. Whereas civilian systems depend on comprehensive codes and statutes to establish obligations, the common law system, originating from customary and feudal rights, grants more power to courts to enforce customs and exercise policy-making authority in private law. 31. As a result of these factors, the common law has demonstrated a notable level of adaptability throughout its evolution, particularly in response to innovations in property use by humans and the emergence of novel sources of wealth. 32. Although John R. Commons argued that in its original conception, property and common law typically pertain to tangible objects. 33. The concept of intangible shows as an action already emerged around the 15th century. 34. As capitalism began to displace feudalism in the 16th century, new business practices proliferated, and new forms of intangible property whose value depended on market activities, such as negotiable instruments, shares, and bills of lading, exploded in popularity. 35. It is true that at certain points in history, conventional understandings of property persisted, as exemplified by William Blackstone's conceptions that property exists exclusively in tangible things, and that shows as in action should lead to physical possession. 36. However, the tradition and inherent characteristics of common law have endowed English courts with the aptitude to handle property issues pragmatically, showcasing a willingness to explore unconventional forms of intangible property. 37. To illustrate, let us consider copyright, which was once a subject of controversy as an intangible property form. Copyright received judicial recognition in the seminal English case of Miller versus Taylor. 38. Justice Ashton, representing the majority view, embraced a broad interpretation of property when confronted with the notion of copyright. He observed that conventional theoretical notions of property, which were fashioned to describe things in a primitive state, were very inadequate to the object of property at this day. 39. Emphasizing progress and advancement as fundamental aspects of property, he said, property was gradually introduced, according as either the condition of things, the number or genius of men required, or as it appeared requisite to the common peace, since those supposed times, therefore, of universal communion, the objects of property have been much enlarged by discovery, invention, and arts. 40. Ashton Jay's approach can be characterized as forward-looking and pragmatic, as he was clearly inclined to depart from theoretical understandings grounded in natural law. His decision was based on the specific context and factual circumstances, recognizing that rules attending property must keep pace with its increase and improvement, and must be adapted to every case. 41. In a similar vein, Justice Wills asserted that the common law's view of property should not be narrow and illiberal, as he perceived the common law as being rooted in the law of nature and reason, drawing from diverse sources such as moral philosophy and societal customs. 42. Rather relying solely on abstract principles, he believed that the scope and breadth of common law should be influenced by a comprehensive understanding of human behavior and societal norms. The aim of common law, therefore, should be directed towards social ends, as Ashton Jay expressly articulated. The outcome of the decision about copyright should enable the learned and industrious not only to reap the fame but also to reap the profits of their ingenious labors, to the honor and advantage of themselves and their families. 43. In order to extend legal protection to copyright owners and recognize copyright as intangible property, Ashton J. moved away from traditional physicalist conceptions of property and showed little concern towards the numerous clauses principle. He constructed an inclusive model of property, characterized by its open-ended nature, stipulating that anything possessing the attributes of discernible existence and value, essentially encompassing all items tradable and deemed valuable, can be recognized as subjects eligible for the creation of property rights. 44. In his dissenting opinion, Justice Yates took a more conservative view and regarded property as a combination of distinct pre-existing forms, asserting that things devoid of physical existence cannot be categorized within any property type. 45. Nevertheless, in acknowledging that the primary purpose of the institution of property was to fulfill a societal objective of maintaining peace among mankind, Yates J. also displayed a sense of pragmatism as he recognized that, in business practices, intangible objects were already commonly regarded as assets subject to buying and selling. 46. The recognition of goodwill, another intangible asset, within the framework of Anglo-American common law, also exemplified the pragmatic approach. Although goodwill arises in various commercial contexts, courts' recognition of it initially stemmed from taxation cases. One of the earliest instances of such is the case of Potter versus Commissioners of Inland Revenue, 47, where Pollock C.B. ruled that the transfer of goodwill as part of a business constituted a conveyance of property under the Stamp Duty Act. He recognized that although there is nothing tangible with goodwill, it very frequently became the subject of sale. 48. In another landmark English case, Inland Revenue Commissioners versus Muller and Co's Margarine Limited, IRC versus Muller, 49. Lord Macnaghten similarly relied on business customs to affirm the property nature of goodwill. He noted that goodwill was bought and sold on a daily basis, and emphasized the conclusive nature of compensating for goodwill where premises were acquired through statutory powers. Initially, the prevailing view was that goodwill could not exist independently, and must always be linked to some tangible entity. 50. For example, in Robertson versus Quiddington, 51, Romilly Mr. said goodwill is never a tangible thing unless it is connected with the business itself. In IRC versus Muller, Lord Lindley said goodwill is inseparable from the business to which it adds value and exists where the business is carried on. Nevertheless, as social developments unfolded, there emerged an increasing disapproval of perceiving goodwill solely through a physicalist lens, particularly in the USA. With courts beginning to recognize goodwill as being associated with value rather than tangibility. 52. The background of this change, according to L.L. Briggs, was courts attempting to keep up with increasing complexities of modern business as the recognition of variations in earnings between constituent concerns and tangible assets became crucial for forming large business combinations in the USA in the 19th century. 53. In light of business or professional goodwill being sold without the transfer of tangible assets, the courts manifested an instrumental approach to the law, carefully weighing its consequences with its application. In a landmark case, Brett v. Ebel, 54, the court acknowledged that deeming such arrangements illegal would significantly affect the sale of any man's business, where the element of goodwill entered into the transaction, and which these arrangements are generally an important incident of every such sale. 55. Through an effort to deliver decisions in line with the specific context and employing incremental decision-making, the courts aim to foster the evolution of the law in response to societal demands. In McFadden versus Jenkins, 56, an exemplary case involving goodwill in a real estate and loan business, the focus of the court, similar to that in Miller versus Taylor, centered on the progressive nature of the law, particularly its capacity for conceptual expansion of property. The law, as other big institutions of modern society, is advancing. It has broadened in its conception of human rights, including property rights. Goodwill, by reason of the great progress of society, is considered to be a property right in a good many instances. 57. Thus, both examples of copyright and goodwill indicate that property, amid the development of common law, underwent a process of dephysicalization, leading to the legal recognition of various intangible property rights by the late 19th century, as the protection of intangible forms of wealth became more important than protecting any tangible object involved. 58 Anglo-American common law, in response to the demands of emerging commercial practices, began to erode the differentiations between property categories, shows as inaction, originally conceived as non-transferable personal rights, gradually expanded to encompass a broad range of new property rights. 59 courts began to adopt a more pragmatic positive-negative dualist approach, wherein shares in possession were assigned as a primary category, while other entities having received legal recognition were loosely grouped as a residual category under shares in action. 60 Over time, these categories lost their strict definitions and, in some sense, became obsolete. Courts began to recognize that property rights should focus on protecting the underlying value inherent in property, and this shift in perspective led to a greater prioritizing of the substance of property over its form. 61. The inclination to prioritize pragmatic considerations eventually set a firm groundwork for the seminal English case of National Provincial Bank Limited versus Ainsworth, which was cited and used as a strong basis for recognizing crypto assets as property. In this case, Lord Wilberforce put forth a set of criteria that needed to be met for something to be classified as property, including being definable, being identifiable by third parties, being capable of assumption by third parties, and possessing some level of permanence or stability. 62. The lack of precise definition and the use of terms like some level suggest that these criteria are more pragmatic than principled. Fast forward to 50 years later, in the case of AA versus Persons Unknown 63, the nature of a new form of property, Bitcoin, was to be determined. Brian J. acknowledged the novelty of Bitcoin and its ambiguous legal status, rather than forcefully fitting it into categories such as shares in possession or shares in action. Brian J. recognized the limitations of confining property within strict classifications. Using the test established in Ainsworth, he concluded that Bitcoin satisfied the four criteria outlined in Ainsworth, hence establishing its status as property. Through this approach, Brian J. skillfully sidestepped the intricacies stemming from the application of fiction piled upon fiction, which might otherwise have been justified in ways that depart from established principles and obscure the reality. 64. This approach showcased the remarkable adaptability of common law in the face of digital assets. The case aptly exemplifies the embracing of a comprehensive conception of property, which aligns with the long-standing pragmatic tradition of common law. Conversion claims and crypto assets in Anglo-American common law, as discussed in the previous subsection. The common law has displayed its adaptability by accommodating new assets within the scope of intangible property. This flexibility extends to the application of legal principles, including the tort of conversion, which guards against unauthorized dealing with a person's goods to deprive the person of use or possession. 65. Traditionally, the position has been that intangible property, which cannot be physically possessed, cannot be the subject of an action in conversion. This is because the basis for the right to sue in conversion relies on possession at the time of the wrongful act. And intangible properties are, in law, not capable of physical possession. Over time, however, the English courts have progressively broadened the tort to encompass documentary intangibles like checks, negotiable instruments, shares, and bonds, allowing for monetary remedy to account for both the physical and intangible value of the document. 66. Although the inclusion of documentary intangibles challenges the conventional distinction between tangible and intangible properties, there is still a prevailing inclination in English law to exclude shares in action, which are purely intangibles, from the purview of conversion. While the statutory regime, the Torts Interference with Goods Act 1977, explicitly states that the torts application does not extend to things in action and money, this cautious perspective was reaffirmed in the OBG Limited versus Allen case, where the House of Lords hesitated to broaden the tort of conversion to include shares in action. They viewed such an expansion as a radical and fundamental change that contradicted the historical principle of reserving conversion for tangible chattels. 67. This is likely one of the contributing factors to the very small number of crypto asset private disputes reaching the English courts. The Law Commission of England, while recognizing the potential of extending the tort of conversion to include data objects, also acknowledges that due to historical circumstances and complexities, any potential reform would likely require legislative intervention. 68 Compared with England, common law in the USA has taken a different path. American copyright law is established in the statutes as decided in Wheaton versus Peters, 69, while Brett versus Ebel established the marketability of the property of goodwill. Importantly, we can observe how flexibility and pragmatism in American common law have extended even further. Initially, the treatment of property within the context of conversion has seen a similar progression in the USA as it has in England. Courts permitted the conversion of select represented by tangible symbols, contingent upon the conversion of the tangible symbols themselves. 70 Subsequently, the Restatement, Second, of Torts recognized conversion pertaining to specific intangible rights, even if the corresponding tangible symbol was not converted, but confining it to intangibles associated with a document. 71 Finally, there was further progression that permitted the conversion of all intangible properties, regardless of the tangible symbol. A recent and important example would be Kremen versus Cohen, 72, where internet domain names were held to constitute intangible personal property subject to the tort of conversion. Due to the U.S. federal system and common law tradition, the USA lacks a uniform set of property laws applicable nationwide, and the autonomy of individual states has allowed their laws to exhibit flexibility to evolve independently from nationwide treatises, such as the Restatement, Second, of Torts. In Kremen versus Cohen, the court determined that California did not follow the Restatement, Second, of Torts, and furthermore, California courts have consistently applied the tort of conversion to various intangible properties without necessitating their merger in a document. Considering this, the court applied the three-part test to determine whether a property right exists that could support a conversion claim, which entails determining if there is an interest that can be precisely defined, if it is capable of exclusive possession or control, and if the alleged owner has established a legitimate claim of exclusivity. The shift away from categorizing properties and towards emphasizing their characteristics shares similarities with the English approach in Ainsworth. The court also commented that, while the legislature is free to refashion the system that courts come up with, the common law does not stand idle while people give away the property of others. Therefore, regulating and protecting property rights are viewed as crucial objectives that the law, as a social tool, must strive to accomplish. Benefiting from the court's pragmatic approach in applying the tort of conversion, individuals in various American states who hold crypto assets can avail themselves of the protection provided by this legal doctrine. In California, courts have entertained crypto asset conversion claims, indicating that these assets, despite their lack of physical form and absence from any tangible document, can be protected under the tort of conversion. 73 In Florida, a plaintiff successfully brought forth a conversion claim relating to bitcoins, with the court recognizing the applicability of conversion tort to bitcoin. 74 In Georgia, while fungible intangible personal property is not typically subject to an action for conversion, crypto assets have been deemed sufficiently identifiable to be eligible for conversion claims. 75 These cases exemplify the evolving legal perspectives surrounding the protection of crypto assets under the tort of conversion in the USA. There are concerns regarding the acceptance of intangible conversions, as it could allow even minimal rights infringement to result in strict liability, rendering conversion a claim susceptible to abuse. 76 In spite of the concerns, crypto assets introduced distinctive complexities that led to challenges in establishing the custodian's duties, analyzing the actions of defendants within the crypto system, and discerning defendants' intent to deprive claimants of their possessory rights. This challenge is particularly pronounced in the context of decentralized autonomous organizations, where decision-making power is distributed among a multitude of individuals. With these intricate issues at play, claimants who want to pursue a crypto asset conversion claim are likely to encounter a significant burden of proof, as the courts take on the ongoing struggle to navigate the ever-changing landscape in this domain. Chinese civil law approach. The development of property law in the People's Republic of China began in the late 1970s when the country emerged from the turmoil of the Cultural Revolution and embarked on a transition to market economy. The Chinese Communist government initiated legal reforms aimed at establishing a property law system that could accommodate the demands of the emerging economic environment. 77 is a communist state. China's emphasis on public ownership has been long-standing. Therefore, the progress in creating a system to protect private property has been both contentious and slow. It was not until 2007 that China enacted the first property code, which was subsequently incorporated into the newly created civil code in 2021. The relatively recent inception of Chinese property law by a communist state stands in stark contrast to the enduring evolution of the common law of property, which traces its origins back to feudal times. Nevertheless, it is argued that Chinese property law exhibits a notable level of pragmatism, resembling the spirit found in Anglo-American common law. Since Chinese property law was first developed as a creative response to the transition from orthodox communist ideologies to pragmatic considerations for an emerging market economy, throughout the reform years, it has enabled numerous alterations to traditional principles as a means of driving radical change. Moreover, due to communist influence, which devalues the importance of private property, the laws of the People's Republic of China originated without strict conceptual labels and rules concerning property and property rights. This has given flexibility for Chinese property law to address emerging forms of property, facilitating its adaptability to the evolving needs of a dynamic society. Indeed, the depiction of Chinese property law by Qiao Shitong as embodying hybridism with a combination of a civil law body, a socialist ghost, and a common law spirit comes as no surprise. 78. Dephysicalization as contemporary state invention. Intangibles in Chinese civil law prior to the reform era. China followed a Soviet-style economic system where all means of production and land were nationalized. Since important economic assets were not under private control, there was little need to create a property law framework. 79. Orthodox communist ideologies also presented significant challenges in adopting capitalist concepts like property ownership. 80. It was after China initiated its economic reforms that the general principles of the civil law, GPCL, promulgated in 1986, laid the groundwork for establishing communist China's first comprehensive property law principles. 81. Still, the influence of Soviet legal ideology was obvious. There was no clear-cut definition of property or differentiation between thing and obligation. Instead, the GPCL sorted properties into three categories: state, collectively owned, and personal. In its implementation, Chinese property law was also fragmented and vulnerable to structural weaknesses, leading to inconsistent treatment and corruption. 82. As this property law was widely criticized due to its impracticality with the circumstances of China in the reform era, 83. There was a major overhaul in the 2007 property law, representing a landmark development of China's property law framework, much like the contemporary transformation of Chinese law, which predominantly involves legal transplantation in pursuit of modernization. The 2007 property law heavily draws inspiration from the German civilian model, while also incorporating components from Japanese and Taiwanese law. 84. Hence, it exhibits resemblances to property laws commonly observed in civilian jurisdictions. For instance, the principle of numerous clauses is incorporated. According to Article 5 of the 2007 property law, also translated as real rights law, 85, which has been incorporated into the civil code as Article 116, the categories and content of the real rights are provided by law, in line with other civilian jurisdictions. The 2007 property law also created a clear distinction between real rights, law of things, and personal rights, law of obligations. Nevertheless, this law has a crucial characteristic that sets it apart from the other models. Unlike civilian jurisdictions such as Germany and Japan, where thing is explicitly defined as tangible, the way thing is defined in Article 2.1 of China's 2007 property law is merely that it consists of immovable and movable things. Instead of creating a clear definition of thing, Chinese property law employs inclusive categorizations that demonstrate a broad and perhaps ambiguous approach in conceptualizing property. The decision to create an open concept of thing was the outcome of extensive academic debates during the drafting phase of the law. In the initial drafts, thing was proposed to include tangible entities only, accommodating the suggestions of German-influenced Chinese legal theorists, who preferred the conventional civilian approach of characterizing real rights as the right to exercise dominion over tangible objects. 86, however, opposing views arose regarding the compatibility of traditional notion of thing with contemporary society, raising questions about whether the concept of thing should be expanded. 87, eventually, this perspective, championed by prominent legal theorist Meng Qingwu, prevailed in the debate, and his proposal was accepted in the final draft of the law. Meng heavily criticized the notion of confining thing to tangible assets, arguing that this approach, originating from the agricultural era, has become a fatal flaw in civil law, resulting in property rights systems that are too rigid and resistant to societal change. 88. The final incorporation of Meng's innovative approach into the 2007 property law was a landmark development in China's legal transplantation, as China intentionally deviated from the long-established civilian tradition by treating thing as an open concept. The need to fit new forms of intangible property into old categories and definitions was circumvented, attaining an immediate dephysicalization of property. The flexibility in adapting to evolving social circumstances, in turn, led to the inevitable compromise of the integrity of conventional civilian legal doctrines. To some extent, this resonates with the stance of legal realists, who perceive the concept of property as counterproductive in addressing novel issues. 89. As Meng contends, the role of China's property law should not be confined by pre-existing definitions and property categories. Instead, its role should be established according to the overarching goals of property law, which is to regulate any property that the law seeks to govern. 90. Meng's pragmatic perspective likely influenced the law's eventual embrace of an expansive notion of thing, thereby granting the law the capability to encompass all economically valuable objects within Chinese society. By adopting this approach, China's property law removed a significant barrier, allowing it to accommodate emerging intangible property forms, which eventually extended to include crypto assets as well. In China's legal academic circles, there remain various theories concerning the legal status of crypto assets like Bitcoin. Notwithstanding the expansive definition of thing, certain Chinese legal theorists influenced by German law continue to argue that thing should remain confined to tangible objects in accordance with the civilian tradition. Hence, Bitcoin should not be classified as a thing capable of being subject to ownership. 91. Amid ongoing uncertainties, Chinese courts have favored a pragmatic approach in handling private disputes involving crypto assets, aiming to streamline their decision-making process and achieve efficient resolutions. Employing pragmatic reasoning, they have demonstrated a propensity to look beyond established property law norms, delving into assessments of alternative legal principles and specific factual contentions. 92. While case precedents in China's civilian system hold less significance than their counterparts in a common law system, they nonetheless provide valuable insights into how Chinese property law is interpreted and applied by courts in cases related to crypto assets, restitution claims, and crypto assets in Chinese civil law. In China, the counterpart to conversion claims and crypto asset private disputes in the Anglo-American common law context would be restitution disputes, fanhuan yu anwo jifen, or contractual disputes, hetan jifen, arising from the defendant's failure to deliver or return contested assets. In a significant number of cases, courts may render decisions without explicitly referring to the nature of crypto assets. For instance, claims for restitution may be rejected due to insufficient evidence supporting the existence of a lending, since restitution claims are only available if the contested assets are things under Chinese property law. In cases where the nature of crypto assets directly influences the outcome, the dephysicalized concept of thing has played a part in courts acknowledging crypto assets as entities eligible for property rights. In the restitution dispute between Ding Hao and Zhai Wenji that concerned a private lending involving Litecoin, a crypto asset, an important issue before the court was whether Litecoin falls under the category of thing. 93. Referring to the definition of thing in the 2007 property law, as well as Article 127 of the GPCL, now Article 127 of the Civil Code, which states that laws particularly providing for the protection of data and online virtual assets shall be followed. The court affirmed that the intangible Litecoin meet the criteria of being classified as a thing and a virtual asset entitled to legal protection. The above case exemplifies how China's inventive approach to traditional civilian property law principles has infused a measure of flexibility into the notion of property. Furthermore, guided by their pragmatic approach, Chinese courts have exhibited an even greater level of flexibility by, at times, choosing not to apply property law in property disputes. In the restitution dispute between Zhu Mimi and Chen Xiaobo, where the claimant sought restitution of lent bitcoins, the defendant argued that bitcoin is not a currency and is not subject to the rule of possession equals ownership, and, therefore, the claimant being merely a possessor does not have the right to restitution. While this argument seems to align with the popular position in civil law, the court did not apply property law principles at all. Rather, it referred to the notice on the prevention of risks associated with Bitcoin issued by China's central bank and other ministries in 2013, which stipulates that Bitcoin should be regarded as a special virtual commodity without currency status. Upon a comprehensive examination of the evidence, which predominantly favored the claimant, the court deduced that the claimant had a valid case, since the government only prohibits Bitcoin's usage as a currency, while allowing its possession, use, and transfer as a commodity. Despite the defendant bringing up property law principles, the court's ruling was firmly rooted in factual analysis and policy considerations, rather than abstract concepts. Similarly, in a restitution dispute between Wang Hui and Feng Xiping, where the nature of Bitcoin was a key issue, the court did not take into account the definition of thing in China's property law 94 by simply referring to Article 127 of the Civil Code. The court determined that crypto assets possess attributes of virtual assets, thereby, claimants enjoyed property rights and the right to ownership. The court's determination of the property nature of Bitcoin was further substantiated through a meticulous assessment of the attributes of Bitcoin, considering various criteria including its economic value, scarcity, exclusivity, and possessability. In terms of value, the generation of Bitcoin requires the investment of material capital for the purchase and maintenance of specialized machinery, and the payment of electricity resources for machine computation losses. It also involves significant time costs. Bitcoin can be transferred and traded for money as consideration, generating economically measurable returns. In terms of scarcity, the total supply of Bitcoin is fixed at 21 million. Its availability is limited. In terms of disposability and exclusivity, Bitcoin holders can possess, use, and profit from Bitcoin. Bitcoin can be transferred and separated. Therefore, Bitcoin meets the constitutive elements of virtual property. It is intriguing to see how the Chinese court's interpretation of property has transcended the boundaries set by statutory principles. This approach, which emphasizes the assessment of property based on its inherent characteristics rather than a strict definition, bears much resemblance to elements found in Lord Wilberforce's approach in Ainsworth. Moreover, the court's method of evaluating Bitcoin's property status and its interpretation of property dynamics unmistakably deviates from communist legal ideology. It appears to be profoundly influenced by the Lockean liberal notion of property being the outcome of individual labor and time. The recognition that property rights rely on scarcity and pragmatic considerations regarding marketability and commercial transferability of assets. 95. In addition to displaying flexibility in interpreting the concept of property, another notable aspect of the Chinese court's approach in crypto asset disputes is the prioritization of policy considerations, particularly adherence to state policies. Since the notice on the prevention of risks associated with Bitcoin, China has taken various additional measures to restrict crypto asset trading and mining. The notice on further preventing and dealing with risks of speculative trading in virtual currency transactions, issued in 2021, further prohibited financial activities related to virtual currencies and called for increased efforts to crack down on illegal activities. As a result, many, if not the majority, of claims were rejected by courts, as legal acts involving virtual currencies were deemed invalid. For example, in the dispute of private lending between Tian and Li, which involved the loan agreement of crypto asset Tether, the court, in rejecting the claimant's case, held that the delivery of Tetherer's loan was an illegal behavior not protected by the law. 96. Citing concerns for the well-being of the community, the court decided that the agreement disrupted the economic and financial order and violated the public interest, such that any resulting losses arising from this shall be borne by the parties involved. Likewise, in the restitution dispute between Ma Zhujuan and Liu Fengqin, the court, while assessing the claimant's request for the defendant to return dogecoins, a crypto asset, expressed criticism towards dogecoins due to its potential impact on society. 97. The court opined that the unauthorized presence of dogecoins seriously disrupts the normal financial order of the country, and it is an object that the country urgently needs to clean up. Hence, instead of concentrating on legal analysis and application, the court's primary focus in such cases revolves around the social consequences at stake, aligning its decisions with state rhetoric and policies. The court utilizes the law as a tool to fulfill policy objectives, which take precedence over any existing business activities and market practices that the state deems inappropriate. The two approaches of legal pragmatism. This article explores how the legally pragmatic approaches of common law in England and the USA, as well as civil law in China pertaining to intangible assets like crypto assets, are underpinned by their historical concepts of property, which diverge significantly from the concept of absolute rights of private ownership. Ownership in common law is traditionally accompanied by fragmentation in equity and availability of clear and simple titles, which provides flexibility for handling a proliferation of interests and rights. 98. The tradition within the legal system of communist China revolves around the supremacy of state control and public ownership. 99. Despite their distinct origins, with Anglo-American common law, stemming from rejection of absolute rights, and Chinese civil law, evolving from rejection of private property, both approaches ultimately introduced a broader concept of property that is different from the civil law tradition, which originated during the era of burgeoning commercial activities and the widespread presence of free capital that strongly favored the notion of absolute private property rights. 100. Inevitably, the relatively open approach to the concept of property gives rise to a number of ambiguities and uncertainties. The Ainsworth test, extensively employed in AA versus persons unknown to ascertain the property nature of crypto assets, has garnered criticism due to its alleged flaws in circular reasoning. 101. Critics argue that Ainsworth exposes how property in common law is a messy concept as lawyers are compelled to navigate its ambiguous nature and shift between meanings without clear delineation, in contrast to civilian systems that employ clear-cut vocabularies to distinguish between property in the in rem or the broader sense. 102. Ainsworth's interpretation of property is said to be problematic, and instead, the recognition of crypto assets should involve the analysis of extra legal conventions within property law. 103. In addition, critics have long questioned the expansion of the tort of conversion to encompass any transferable right, arguing that for a right to be classified as a property right, it must exhibit thing-relatedness. 104. While these criticisms may hold some validity, they are, as I contend, modes of thinking largely influenced by the civilian property law tradition. As I discussed, the idea of absolute ownership and the strict distinctions between real rights and personal rights are inherent to civil law. The common law of property is characterized by its flexible and pragmatic orientation, allowing for the accommodation of emerging societal practices without getting overly entangled in abstract concepts. In the contemporary context, where proprietary rights bear implications for third parties and information costs are often significant, the Ainsworth test embodies a pragmatic commitment to policy realities, rather than an endeavor to construct an unambiguous and conclusive checklist. 105. Given that the value of an asset is frequently contingent upon its marketability and commercial transferability, it is imperative for an asset to be definable, verifiable, and stable. These characteristics enable the assessment of an asset's influence on benefits and burdens, thus facilitating the determination of the asset's ultimate price. Through recognizing assets with these characteristics as property, courts effectively uphold the common law tradition of acknowledging extra-legal business practices, thus promoting coherence and harmony between commercial and legal perspectives. The ambiguities intrinsic to Anglo-American common law's interpretation of property should be regarded in a more positive light as a strength, underscoring its capacity to adjust to a diverse array of evolving property-related scenarios rather than being considered a weakness. Similar to the alleged ambiguities of the Ainsworth test, the open concept of thing in Chinese property law, despite its advantages in enabling flexibility, renders it an overarching term that lacks precise distinction. Meng noted the decision to avoid the specific definition of thing left it vulnerable to being interpreted according to mainstream Chinese academic theories, with which he disagrees. 1.106, for example, prominent legal theorist Liang Yongjin firmly argued that the restriction of thing to movable and immovable entities essentially pertains solely to tangible properties, and he urged for intangible properties such as virtual assets to be regulated by dedicated legislation and not the property law. 107. Nonetheless, according to Meng, the adoption of an inclusive concept of thing should be seen as a tactful departure from the German civilian tradition that enables Chinese property law to encompass a wide array of property in real life situations and serve as the cornerstone of property in Chinese society. 108. Property law is perceived as both a mirror of and a catalyst for the evolving vision of societal progress. Intangible assets are an integral part of the evolution of social life. When social life requires the expression and fulfillment of its own needs through intangible means, corresponding intangible assets will inevitably emerge. The introduction of any form of intangible asset inevitably influences and alters existing property relationships and concepts to a certain extent or within a certain scope, leading to friction and conflicts with established property rules, necessitating a change in behavioral norms. As these behavioral norms associated with intangible assets become more prevalent, they eventually evolve into legal rules. 109. This approach to law, grounded in social reality and practice, and asserting that the law should be based on actual circumstances and adapt to changing conditions, again aligns closely with the ideas of legal pragmatism. 110. Directing our focus to England, clear parallels can be drawn with the views expressed in the legal statement on the status of cryptosets and smart contracts. Legal statement, an influential document published by the UK jurisdictional task force that is widely read and cited, including in AA versus Persons Unknown. In supporting the recognition of crypto assets as property, the legal statement argues that the great advantage of common law is its inherent flexibility, and the aim of law is to support reasonable expectations in commerce and accommodate innovation. The great advantage of the English common law system is its inherent flexibility, rather than depending on the often cumbersome, time-consuming and inflexible process of legislative intervention. Judges are able to apply and adapt by analogy existing principles to new situations as they arise. In commerce, the law is there to support and fulfill reasonable expectations. Time and again over the years, the common law has accommodated technological and business innovations, including many which, although now commonplace, were at the time no less novel and disruptive than those with which we are now concerned. 111. While a clear resonance in attitudes can be observed, there are also obvious differences in the legally pragmatic approaches that we can notice between Anglo-American common law and Chinese civil law. In the former, judges play a significant role in shaping the legal landscape. Alongside statutory interventions, dephysicalization of property has been progressively accomplished due to the pragmatic stance taken by judges, aiming at accommodating innovative property forms in response to evolving business practices and social conventions. As Shyam Krishna Balganesh describes in his examination of the common law's evolution regarding intellectual property, the common law develops incrementally, recognizing the need for caution in a rapidly changing social and technological environment, and allowing future courts to extend, limit, or, at times, deny protection when circumstance and context change. 112. On the contrary, the approach in China is significantly state-centric, with the entire process being driven by the government. The decision to adopt Meng's proposal to dephysicalize property was ultimately made by the state, possibly with the intention of enhancing regulation efficiency, while English and American courts, along with Chinese courts, resort to ad hoc legal strategies, and at times decouple legal doctrine from practice by factoring in contextual elements in property disputes, it becomes evident that policy considerations exert a far more substantial impact on the decisions made by Chinese courts. 113. The caution exhibited by Chinese courts regarding innovative developments is not intended to protect the integrity of existing legal principles, but rather to ensure compliance with state directives, given that the issuance, interpretation, and application of the substatutory categories of Chinese law, such as the regulatory notices regarding crypto assets, are under the tight control of the administrative bureaucracies of the state. 114. Chinese courts are typically bound to rigorously uphold the authority of these normative documents, and the role of property law, in this context, can be fairly limited. It is not implied that all Chinese courts lack autonomy and are totally assimilated into the state bureaucratic system. The examples shown illustrate how certain Chinese courts have exhibited autonomy by navigating around the constraints and uncertainties of state directives concerning crypto assets, achieved by accepting claims from individuals involved in private crypto activities and adopting notably liberal interpretations of property rights. However, China's legal pragmatism remains different from employing law as an incremental means to fulfill societal demands, favoring instead instrumental outcomes to strengthen state control under the pretext of promoting general well-being of the masses. In China's long march towards the rule of law, Chinese property law principles have indeed deviated from communist tradition, but this departure does not extend to Chinese law as a whole. The law is often perceived as a tool of the state, with government rhetoric consistently asserting that the authorities possess the insight into what serves the best interests of the population. 115. Given the different legal traditions and historical contexts, it is unsurprising that the courts have played a big part in shaping Anglo-American common law's legal pragmatic approach towards property, while the state plays a leading role in Chinese civil law. After all, common law, with its customary and feudal origins, adopts a bottom-up approach rather than a top-down one. Its development in England involved the assimilation of regional legal structures, resulting in a system shaped by judges, lawyers, royal councillors, and parliamentarians who approached the law from a local, practical perspective rather than that of philosophers or scholars seeking to establish a set of legal doctrines applicable across territories. 116. In the classical liberal perspective put forth by James L. Huffman, the common law courts resolve disputes by confirming the prevailing customs with judicial guidelines, which are constantly assessed and evolved to ensure their coherence with popular expectations. 117. The gradual adaptation of the law to changing circumstances and human preferences represents a spontaneous order that obviates the need for overarching principles and offers a degree of certainty in people's daily lives. However, due to its spontaneous and adaptive nature, it is inherent for the pace of evolution to be relatively slow, as acknowledged by Hayek, who concedes that legislation may be required when the development of case law is too slow to bring about the desirable rapid adaptation of the law to wholly new circumstances. 118. The process of legal evolution, stemming from adversarial litigation, is also criticized for its inefficiency, being deemed a rent-seeking process with unpredictable outcomes. 119. The approach to legal evolution in China, driven by the state, can be notably efficient. The Chinese Communist government's complete monopoly of power naturally leads to an emphasis on state-driven legal changes through the enactment or revision of legislation, rather than devolving power to the courts. But apart from relying on statutes to facilitate swift transformations in social practices, what sets Chinese civil law apart from other civilian jurisdictions is its inherent ideology of flexibility and ambiguity. In essence, China has adopted a legal system that mirrors the fluid and changeable nature of the economy and society it regulates, aiming to promote national economic development while considering local circumstances. It is believed that law should not be too specific lest it tie our hands and feet in the face of the rapidly changing situation. 120. With this spirit of legal pragmatism, Chinese civil law embraces constant shifts in the substance and enforcement of legal rules, prioritizing flexibility in legal concepts, such as the dephysicalization of the notion of property. Still, It is important to recognize that this legal pragmatism remains a state-driven initiative, guided by the prevailing reform-era ideology of the Chinese Communist government. In contrast, during the tumultuous pre-reform era, state ideology was characterized by dogmatic attitudes towards orthodox communist principles and a nihilistic approach towards the law. With a monopoly on power, the state may be reluctant to adapt or even suppress certain social changes, as the law becomes a tool solely created and manipulated by the state. Conclusion: while many civilian jurisdictions required complex legislations to extend legal recognition to intangible objects like crypto assets, 121, the recognition of crypto assets as a new property form has been relatively straightforward in England, the USA, and China. This article aims to account for this phenomenon by arguing that Anglo-American common law and Chinese civil law, influenced by their unique origins and development, have adopted disparate yet legally pragmatic approaches in conceptualizing property and formulating property law principles, characterized by a deliberate shift away from the strictly physical notion of property. The concept of property is made open, malleable, and adaptable to societal advancements, setting it apart from that of the continental civil law jurisdictions. Admittedly, there are nuances among different types of crypto assets. For instance, the legal status of stablecoins like Tether and USDC in private law is not explicitly defined, and their US dollar pegged value and intermediary role in crypto transactions could make them eligible for currency exceptions to the NEMA-DAT rule in property law. 122 Still, in the broader context of crypto assets, the legally pragmatic approach has mitigated significant hurdles in integrating them into the domain of property rights, despite their intangible, diverse, and innovative characteristics. The legal acknowledgement has not resulted in the crypto assets industry of these three nations overcoming all hurdles and thriving as many might have anticipated. Notably, in China, the government has effectively banned crypto asset financial trading, favoring state-issued and controlled alternatives. Although England still aspires to become a global crypto asset technology hub, 123 in the USA, high-profile regulatory actions against prominent crypto industry participants like Binance have been taken by the Securities and Exchange Commission for unregistered offers and sales of securities. As some crypto assets are classified by the commission as such, 124, it is indeed an interesting development that both China and the USA seem to be heading in the same direction of restricting financial activities related to crypto assets. China's example illustrates that the foundation laid by deliberate adaptive ingenuity in property law and the court's open attitude towards crypto assets can be readily intercepted by powerful state initiatives. While Anglo-American courts maintain the power to interpret, apply, and mold the law, frequently invoking sources that are more open to the innovative characteristics of crypto assets, the future will reveal whether their legally pragmatic stance in embracing emerging technologies can withstand the trials brought about by unprecedented government interventions. Funding: the author received no financial support for the research, authorship, and/or publication of this article. Conflict of interest statement: the author declared no potential conflicts of interest with respect to the research, authorship, and/or publication of this article. Copyright the author, S. 2024, published by Oxford University Press. This is an open access article distributed under the terms of the Creative Commons Attribution License, https://creativecommons.org/licenses/by/4.0/, which permits unrestricted reuse, distribution, and reproduction in any medium, provided the original work is properly cited. Alvin Ho Chun Hung, Evolution of Intangible Property to Crypto Assets, Legal Pragmatism in Anglo-American Common Law and Chinese Civil Law, The Chinese Journal of Comparative Law, Volume 12, 2024, C011, https://doi.org/10.1093/cjcl/cz011.